بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سعادة الشيخ حمد بن ثامر الثاني رئيس مجلس إدارة شبكة الجزيرة، معالي رئيس المجلس الأعلى للدولة في ليبيا السيد خالد المشري، معالي وزير الخارجية الصومالي السيد أحمد عيسى عوض، أصحاب السعادة السفراء وأعضاء السلك الدبلوماسي المعتمدين في دولة قطر، السيدات والسادة الحضور الكريم، متابعينا على شاشات ومنصات شبكة الجزيرة، في مثل هذا اليوم من كل عام نلتقي هنا في دوحة الخير لنتحاور في أهم القضايا التي تمس شعوب المنطقة. ينعقد منتدى الجزيرة والأزمة الخليجية لا تزال تراوح مكانها منذ أن بدأت قبل عامين. تلك الأزمة التي لم يعد تأثيرها قاصراً فقط على ما هو سياسي واجتماعي، بل امتد ليشمل الوزن الاستراتيجي للمنظومة الخليجية بأكملها. ففي الوقت الذي تراجع فيه التأثير الاستراتيجي للخليج إقليمياً وقل حضوره عالمياً، ها نحن نرى قواً إقليمية في الجوار يتصاعد تأثيرها ويمتد نفوذها. فإلى أين تمضي هذه الأزمة في الخليج دولاً وشعوباً؟ وأي أفق ينتظرها وسط أزمات تهدد الاستقرار وانقسامات تضعف القرار وسباق تسلح يستنزف الموارد ويبدد الطاقات وينذر بخطر الانجرار إلى مزيد من النزاعات والحروب. الخليج بين الأزمة وتراجع التأثير الاستراتيجي هو عنوان منتدانا في دورته الثالثة عشرة، والذي يسعدنا أن نستضيف فيه نخبة من السياسيين والمفكرين والخبراء يتداولون الرأي فيما بينهم عبر جلسات رئيسية وموازية تمتد على مدار يومين. نأمل أن تكون ثرية today and tomorrow, and hopefully this content will be fruitful.
الحضور الكريم،
ladies and gentlemen,
اسمحوا لي أن أستهل المنتدى بدعوة سعادة الشيخ حمد بن ثامر الثاني رئيس مجلس إدارة شبكة الجزيرة
the chairperson of Al-Jazeera Media Network to deliver his speech. Thank you. In the name of God, the most gracious, the most merciful. Ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning to you. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be upon you. Allah's blessing and His mercy. I would like to welcome you at the 13th edition of Al Jazeera Forum, whereby every year we call upon a constellation of pundits, thinkers, media personalities to exchange insights without any censorship. The Al Jazeera Media Network is being adept at being acquainted with what goes on in this region. Indeed, this follow-up, this insistent follow-up, uncovers the fact that our people want development and they want to contribute in the universal civilization positively and effectively. The political crisis of the last years had provided us with an impetus, especially when it comes to Sudan, Algeria, for example, and it was emblematic to the fact that our people want to move ahead with their development, and they are indeed maturing. They want to cleave to the civilized methods for the sake of building reconciled societies from within and with internal relationship with others. There are plenty of ambitions and plenty of crises in our region, and indeed the Gulf crisis has started 2 years ago
and it played a negative role in driving a wedge between the Gulf people, and it threatened the security of our region and stripped these countries from becoming influential in our neighborhood. Before that, the Gulf people wanted more effective steps to unify the currency, to have one passport. However, the crisis has eroded the confidence. The leaders couldn't meet up again. As a matter of fact, this crisis is ominous, and it cannot be compared with the yesteryear's crises. Undoubtedly, the erosion of confidence nowadays between the people and the leaders is manifest. In the past, the Arab countries, some of them were at loggerheads with each other. However, now we are talking about the people. The peoples, and thus families were torn apart, especially the Qatari families. They couldn't extend bridges with the other families and their siblings, and in the Emirates and Saudi Arabia and other countries. And this had affected negatively the peoples of the region rather than affecting the leaders per se. Unfortunately, this crisis, the one who provoked it wanted it to be prickly and convoluted and negative. The other part that I want to talk about here or shed light on is to do with the erosion of confidence. As I said, I think part of the problem that we are facing in the Gulf is to do with the confidence erosion. As you know, the reason of establishing the council was to do with the Iranian-Iraqi war. We wanted to protect ourselves from any foreign threat. However, the threat nowadays is from within. It is internal. It is inherent. The problem that we are facing that relates to confidence is emblematic to the fact that a blockade has been leveled against Qatar. However, I think that this crisis might become a domino effect. Another country in the Gulf might be put or subjected to a blockade as well. Other countries might do the same to a certain country or a given country in the Gulf. Three countries might gang up on a fourth or a fifth. So I think that the erosion of confidence ought to be remedied, ought to be looked at, ought to be scrutinized from the media and from the researchers, because this is an unprecedented crisis. And I think this Gulf crisis is deep-rooted, and everybody is suffering from everybody speaks to himself or herself to the fact that this crisis is indeed threatening. We hope that we would surpass and overcome this crisis. I wish so, and hopefully, God willing, we are always optimistic, and we hope that the peoples of the Gulf and the countries of the Gulf would go back to square one and overcome this crisis, God willing. The blockading countries had not met their objectives. They had crippled the influence of the council. They drove a wedge between the Gulf countries after the council was coherent in the yesteryear. Ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to welcome you again in Doha. I would like to say that Al Jazeera Media would always be a platform for constructive dialogue whereby insights do meet with all respect. I'd like to welcome you and thank you, and very good morning to you. Assalamu alaikum, peace be upon you.
نشكر سعادة الشيخ حمد بن ثامر الثاني على هذه الكلمة والآن ننتقل
ميديا
بكم إلى الكلمة الرئيسية الأولى يلقيها معالي رئيس المجلس الأعلى للدولة في ليبيا سيد خالد المشري.
Will be delivered by President of the High Council of State in Libya. Please, خالد المشري, the floor is yours.
صباح الخير.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
May the peace and blessings of God be upon you all.
السيدات والسادة الحضور الكريم.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen.
أتقدم بالشكر للجزيرة أولاً.
I would like to extend my thanks first and foremost to Al Jazeera Center for Studies for the invitation to attend this forum in its 13th edition.
وإنه لمن دواعي سروري.
It is my pleasure
to be here
with a constellation of researchers. Thinkers who are very much interested to topical issues in politics and other realms. Research centers have become, in many countries, governmental centers that do not help the decision-makers clarify the vision that precedes the decision-making process. But what we have seen as outcomes and results achieved by this particular center has made it very, very distinctive indeed, helping decision makers in this country and other countries as well. It is a very important intellectual center that has contributed and still does when it comes to deepening awareness when it comes to the reality of challenges and also to reinforce knowledge and also to foresee the future of this nation and also to help it
ونحن في العالم العربي والإسلامي ما نحوز
We in the Arab and Islamic world are in dire need today in order to raise the voice of knowledge popularly and also officially in order to retrieve our position and also contribute to the development of civilization. The absence of official interest in research centers and think tanks has been very apparent in the figures فهي لا تتعدى في الدول العربية in such kind of centers which is no more than 2 out of 1,000 which is the smallest in any kind of regional countries or nations particularly when we compare it to neighboring countries the neighboring countries of the Arab world in general Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, when we talk about the GCC crisis and the blockade on the state of Qatar, takes us back to the beginning of the 80s of the 20th century when I was a student at university. And I used to look at this kind of council as a nucleus for a number of larger projects to take place, particularly in the light of the consensus between the different countries of the GCC, which is not in keeping with other Arab groups, particularly when it comes to the similarity economically, geographically, and socially. All these are factors meant that such a council was going to achieve strides and a great deal of development. And here, after in excess of 35 years, we used to think that we were going to see one unified passport, currency, harmony, complementarity in relations. So this region, we were thinking that it was going to be a theme of stability, a destination for stability, but this did not happen as a result of attempts by a number of countries to force or to swallow other countries that are not in conformity or in line with their own policies. And they have moved from such kind of efforts of complementarity, they wanted to move to containment, which is not acceptable. So this kind of relationship, in addition to the destabilization of the Council, has led to so many repercussions, GCC, regional, and also international repercussions. In the light of such kind of blocks, and also due to the helplessness of certain countries, we have seen that there are two blocks now taking place. these repercussions and ramifications with regard to the GCC have led to a division which is different from the situation that used to be before. But I think this crisis is the most dangerous and the most difficult. This is threatening to the security and stability of the GCC countries for the one simple reason is that so many countries after such a division, so many of them have become trying to attempt to secure their own security through security and military cooperation with countries outside the GCC bloc. And this means that this region, instead of resorting to joint and common kind of defense, as we used to hear in the past, now we're talking about regional security and the protection of those regional borders. And these countries that I'm talking about are part and parcel of this council. In addition to that, it is clear that the GCC has become unable to confront external challenges, the challenges that are close to their borders, particularly when it comes to the permanent threat to the national security of Arab countries, Israel, in addition to Iran. This crisis had an impact on the region, particularly the countries of the Arab Spring, and this is something which is very important when it comes to my country, Libya. Unfortunately,
الجزء الذي حاول احتواء الآخرين وليس التعاون في مجلس الدول التعاون الخليجي
part that tries to contain others tried also to contain those revolutions through the establishment of counter-revolutions and not supporting the revolutions that are taking place. And despite the fact that many GCC countries thankfully tried to help the GCC, to help to the Arab Spring countries, but we find that there are other countries that have tried in a way or another to put an end to this nascent democracies.
We,
and in the light of the re-establishment or the reinstatement of such a crisis, we see that these impacts are very clear indeed. And through the different reports of the United Nations, so these countries are held responsible for what is taking place in Libya. At a time when we had a unified position by the GCC vis-à-vis the revolution in Libya, and when the GCC Council recognized the revolution and the support of the Libyan revolution, and Qatar was the first country to recognize the transitional council and the second country in the world, but many countries did not, and the state of Qatar finds itself in a very difficult situation when it comes to defending these revolutions that it started defending and supporting from day one. So the political pathway through financial support and the counter-revolution by certain countries has led to the continuation and procrastination of the situation and crisis in Libya. And the last testament to such a matter is what we see today, which is the war on Tripoli.
The حاولت تلك الفترة السابقة الالتزام بكل ما تم الاتفاق عليه في سفارات وباريس وباليرمو وانتهاج مبدأ الحوار لحل الأزمة الليبية ونقلها إلى مرحلة الاستقرار
dialogue based on what has been agreed on in Sykhirat and Palermo and so on and so forth, and all this effort was in cooperation with the Presidential Council and also the UN mission and in coordination with the parliament as much as possible. So whenever we try to put an end to this crisis through meetings that were supposed to take place on the 14th of April under the sponsorship of the United Nations and during the visit of the Secretary General of the United Nations to Tripoli on the 3rd and 4th and 5th of April, we were surprised to see the forces of Haftar on the western part of Libya and trying to storm the region and any hope for any political solution to take place. And that is why all the agreements that have been concluded in Paris, Palermo, and Sykhirat, all of them have become to no avail and part of the past in light of what is taking place now. And unfortunately,
Haftar
wouldn't have done what he's doing hadn't he been directly supported by so many GCC countries. And this support was very clear during his visit to Saudi Arabia a few days ago before the attack that he started. And the expert group that is part of the Security Council on Libya, they have talked about the different violations that are being taken, that is taking place as a result of all the aid, military aid that is being given and assistance. And also they have described the fact that there are 150 vehicles to Tobruk in favor of Haftar, and also they have also used a ship in order to take weapons from the Emirates to Tobruk. And the same report says that they have used a number of aircraft and a number of Russian-made weapons, A-24B, in the eastern part of Libya, in addition to having a number of Emirati forces in one of the bases over there. The report also talks about other violations that have taken place, and they have been written in detail about what is taking place. And also, in its official report in August 2014, the United States of America said that the Arab Emirates and Egypt, they have had direct attacks on the revolutionaries, and this was underlined by France, Britain, and the EU, the United States and Britain, and they have warned that this is going to deepen divisions and rifts within Libya. Internal divisions. So this support also had another impact on humanitarian spheres. We have seen a number of wounded in Iqris and so on and so forth, and such works and attacks have had an impact on Tripoli. And this is a report that dates back to 3 days ago. We have in excess of 272 and also we have had 1282 wounded. And also the High Commissioner for Human Rights also talks about the displacement of so many people to these conflict zones. And also the reports of the Ministry of Education talks about so many students who have been deprived of having access to education. And we're talking here about in excess of 60,000 countries and many of the GCC countries who have imposed the blockade on the state of Qatar. They have targeted a civil airport while being operative, and also they have targeted mosques and also educational institutions and mosques, Jerusalem schools, and so on and so forth. And this has led to the burning of so many school books, in addition to indiscriminate attacks and shelling, and the impact on so many houses and households, and this has led to a medical crisis also due to limited pieces of equipment and supplies. So also this had an impact on the whole of Libya, and also this has led to the shelter areas, and particularly those areas that are dedicated to people who are committing illegal immigration through the sea.
So
these countries that wanted to control the decision-making by the state of Qatar, these countries are the same ones that are supporting a war criminal, and this is leading to so many political repercussions, and going back to dialogue maybe is going to be a thing of the past before these forces go back to where they used to be and holding the aggressor accountable. And this has led to so many economic repercussions as well that might lead to limiting the exports of oil. There are so many violations that are being committed, such as the recruitment of underage people and so on and so forth. We
in Libya, we are not very much surprised vis-à-vis what is being carried out and vis-à-vis the incentives of countries that have carried out a blockade on a country with whom they have so many agreements. But I think that there are some economic reasons behind such kind of moves and attacks.
وهذه التداعيات بالنسبة للأزمة الخليجية نرى أثارها أيضاً إقليمية على اليمن وأيضاً على سوريا وربما الآن على السودان أيضاً. ختاماً أيها الأخوة الأفاضل، لا يسعني إلا أن أشيد بقدرة قطر على كسر الحصار، فقد أثبتت أنها دولة قادرة على إنهاء هذه الأزمات، وربما الفضل يعود بعد الله سبحانه وتعالى لمثل هذه المراكز البحثية، وقامت بسد العجز في وارداتها، وبعض الواردات أصبحت صادرات حسب ما ذكر لي وزير الاقتصاد في زيارة سابقة.
As a result of the need of goods through imports, and we have seen much more movement in the airports of the region more than with what used to have in the past. And the GCC countries, if they do not go back to their own council, if they do not go back to observe their agreements, these countries are going to have an impact on the region. In my country, for instance, although we have financial capabilities, but there are hundreds of billions of dollars of investment opportunities. So
if
the GCC Council does not regain the spirit based on which it was established, I think that scopes of cooperation are going to be lost where they exist. So that is why I would like to underline that the support of the region is linked to the support of the GCC. Once again, I would like to reiterate my thanks to the Al Jazeera Center for Studies and all the guests attending this forum. And we hope that we're going to be able to see a GCC as it used to be, with an effective regional role. And we do not want its strategic role to wane as it is happening now. Thank you so much, and may the peace and blessings of God be upon you all.
نشكر معالي رئيس المجلس الأعلى للدولة في ليبيا سيد خالد المشري على هذه الكلمة، وندعو السيد مهدي أكار النائب في البرلمان التركي للإلقاء كلمة.
The floor is yours, sir, the former deputy chairman of the EKER party.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Distinguished participants, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor and pleasure to address the Al Jazeera Forum. Taking this opportunity, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this distinguished forum. I'm pleased to be in the brotherly state of Qatar on this occasion, with which Turkey is enjoying exemplary relations at all levels. Our bilateral relations are guided by the close friendship and harmony between our leaders and peoples. While bilateral visits between our countries take place regularly at each level, the Supreme Strategic Committee, which was established in 2014, serves as the institutional framework of our ever-deepening relations. During recent years, our region has faced turmoil, as crisis broke out in a wide area, from Syria to Yemen, and from Libya to Afghanistan. Apart from these hot conflicts, the picture in the Gulf looks complicated too, if not bleak, as the ongoing rivalries and crisis undermine the security and the common future of the Gulf region. These have repercussions not only in the region, but also beyond. In the center of this picture, I regret to see the unjust and illegitimate blockade and sanctions against Qatar, which has been going on for almost 2 years now. Unfortunately, this dispute has started to threaten the harmony and future of the Gulf Cooperation Council, which has served as a successful security and economic umbrella for the Gulf region for the past 38 years. The dispute also has the potential to put an irreparable damage on mutual trust and confidence among the brotherly Gulf peoples. Turkey perceives the security and stability of the Gulf as dear as its own national security. When the blockade on Qatar was imposed, my country, Turkey, rushed to stand by its Qatari brothers and sisters and shipped tons of goods and livestock to Qatar. As a strategic partner of the GCC, we called on the parties to exercise restraint and engage in unconditional dialogue to resolve this artificial dispute. We have also strongly supported Kuwait's mediation efforts. Turkey holds that the blockade, sanctions, and restrictions imposed on Qatar since June 2017 should be lifted immediately and the dispute be resolved through dialogue based on the principles of mutual respect, full sovereignty of states, non-interference in internal affairs, and good neighborly relations. At the same time, we are glad to see that Qatar emerged stronger out of this crisis and diversified its economy. We also appreciate Qatar's increasing interest in becoming part of multilateral organizations outside its region, such as the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, as well as its improving relations with NATO since the outbreak of this dispute. On the other hand, we witness efforts to establish a new security architecture in the Gulf region by bringing together some regional countries under a security umbrella, the Middle East Strategic Alliance, shortly MESA, also commonly referred to as the Arab NATO. While we are ready to support any initiative that would increase the general security environment in the region, we hold that there are certain criteria to be met, any initiative to be meaningful and successful. First, the ongoing Gulf dispute must be settled based on the principles I have just mentioned, so that a common sense of security can take root in the region. Second, any security mechanism should adhere to the principle of indivisibility of security and should not be constructed at the expense of others. Historical experience shows that policies of economic isolation and military threat paved the way for greater political tensions and arms race leading to counterproductive results. For peace and security to flourish in our region, inclusive engagement and dialogue must be preferred over unilateral economic isolation and military threats. Third, sectarian policies must be abandoned as they lead to greater polarization, extremism, and proxy wars. Yemen is a sad case in this context, and as a result, our Yemeni brothers and sisters are suffering from the worst human-made disaster of modern times. Sanctions, proxy wars, and exclusions not only threaten regional stability, they also cause the erosion of international law in our region. This erosion recently made itself once again visible through the heinous murder of journalist Jamal Khashoggi. While we perceive this brutal incident as a legal matter and not as a bilateral political issue between Turkey and Saudi Arabia, we expect nothing less than full clarification of this incident with all its dimensions. With these words, ladies and gentlemen, I hope I managed to leave you with some food or thought regarding the importance of displaying greater solidarity in the face of common regional challenges, pursuing policies of engagement and dialogue, and adhering to the supremacy of international law. Taking this opportunity, I wish fruitful discussions at this distinguished forum. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
نشكر السيد مهدي أكار على هذه الكلمة.
والآن اسمحوا لي
قبل أن نبدأ جلستنا
Before we move to the first session, I would like to allude to a number of points. These sessions are being broadcasted on Al Jazeera Mubashir and our digital platforms.
We, as a matter of fact,
want to encourage the viewers to follow AJ Forum, the hashtag. As well as certain applications for this forum
under the title of AJ Forum.
And you can consult these applications and you can follow
the streamline ماجد الأنصاري والسيد محمد المختار الشنقيطي
محمد المختار الشنقيطي
والسيد
سامي
الفرج
والسيد روري ميلر كما أدعو زميلي
عثمان أي فرح لإدارة الجلسة الأولى أما أنا فأشكركم وإلى اللقاء بحول الله
will be managing the first session. I would like to thank you for your listening and a very good morning to you.